Now let's join Pastor Holland live at Calvary Chapel in Connecticut.
Joshua chapter 1. Joshua chapter 1. And today, it's the last Sunday of the year. And I always ask the Lord to speak to me and to give me some direction for the coming year, to give me a word for us for the year on what we could expect. And oftentimes I'll go back and I'll look at what the Lord spoke to me last year and to see if I'm not a false prophet or not. And I tried to actually get the audio, the video clip, but it wasn't there. The service was there, but it cut off when my message started, so maybe that's prophetic. What he told us last year, as we move into 2019, he said we can expect spiritual battles in 2019. He says there's an enemy who makes war with you, and so we can expect the enemy to use people to attack us. But remember what Elisha said, "Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And he told us to treat your attackers with kindness and compassion, because they may not realize that they're being used by the enemy. And also he said, don't let skepticism keep you from stepping into God's plans and purposes for 2019. And leave skepticism in 2018 and step into 2019 full of faith, trusting God for what he desires to do. And so as I reflected over 2019, I can say it was a year of battle. It was a year of battle. There were many battles that came into full-fledged warfare in 2019. The warfare was intense, and it came through people. It was intense in our nation. When I look at the battle in the streets, when I look at what's happening to our president, we witnessed an unprecedented impeachment of a sitting president. I won't go into all the details. I'll go into some of that in our New Year's Eve prophecy update as to how that fits into the prophetic scheme of things. It was intense in our city with the homeless issues and the things that divided our city. It was intense in our church with regards to our building and just trying to get into this building here. We were told at the beginning of the year, if we built that wall over there, that where it used to be a roll-up door, and we were told if we built that wall over there, that we would be able to move into the building before Easter. And so we built the wall. And after we built the wall, we were told it wasn't enough. There was more you had to do. And we did everything that we were told, but we were told that there was more, and there was a lot of confusion about what we needed to do. What we didn't know is that the inspector that was assigned to us was anti-Christian, was anti-church. And this person put a burden on us that we didn't have to carry, and a layer of confusion that we couldn't understand. And this went on for 8 months. And so I began to pray. I began to pray for breakthrough. During this time, someone asked me if I was sure that the Lord was in our moving into this building. Because after nearly 2.5 years of trying to do something, either the Lord is in it and does, or the Lord doesn't want it, or Satan doesn't want it. It's one of the two. You know, there's something that's preventing it from happening. And I had people even tell me the Lord wasn't in it. And I was, you know, doing something that was, I was fighting against the Lord, and we even lost some people over it. But the fog of confusion was so thick. Everybody that looked at our situation said, we don't understand why you guys aren't in there. What's the problem? We said, we don't know what the problem is. We keep trying to find out what the problem is, and no one will tell us. And the confusion was thick. And so because the confusion was thick, I knew that we were in a spiritual battle, because God is not the author of confusion, right? Amen. Is that an amen?
Amen.
When God leads, it's clear. And even though there's resistance, it's still clear. And for a period of time, the church was divided because of unbelief. People believed the lies of the enemy. And so I prayed for breakthrough. And the Lord sent a deliverer to break through. And this deliverer was able to cut through all of the confusion and get us back on track. But even with the breakthrough, there were these unexplained delays. There was faulty equipment. There were contractors that just wouldn't show up. We discovered all of a sudden that there were these additional inspections that we had to have, which I thought, wow, no one ever told us we had to have these additional inspections. And so I kept praying for breakthrough. And finally, the inspector that was assigned to us had a sudden death in the family and couldn't finish our inspections, was taken out of the process. And another inspector came to us, and he was a believer. And this believer is the one that revealed to us the process that we had been through was one of spiritual warfare. That there was someone that was against God, against the church, and was working to make things as difficult for us as he possibly could. And in fact, apologized. He said, you should have been in March. You should have been in for Easter. Because he was the one that came out and signed off on the wall. He said, this should have happened, and he apologized for it. Now, what's interesting, see, that's real spiritual warfare. How many of you can understand that that's real spiritual warfare? That's how warfare actually happens. And when we announced, actually, in December 1st, that we were going to have our first service here, we actually didn't have any sign-offs at that time. None of the inspections had been signed off on because of all the delays that had occurred. But the Lord spoke to me, and he said that this was a battle, and that I needed to stand by faith in order to see breakthrough. And so I said, we're doing it on December 1st, and guess what? God broke through. Amen. God broke through. Okay. If you're going to praise the Lord, do it right. That's like what the Demoncrats do. Half-heartedly praise the Lord. But here's the part that blew me away. This is what really blew me away. During this 2.5 year period of confusion and delay and battle, we were paying $116,000 in double rent. And for a church our size, that's really hard to do. Unless the Lord is on your side. And guess what? The Lord was on our side. And the Lord provided through his people. The Lord provided through his people. So the warfare has been intense in the churches of San Clemente. There's been battles lost. I know of one church that closed its doors this year, folded up, a church that was meeting near here. There have been casualty of wars. I know of at least two pastors who were taken down by the enemy in our city, no longer ministering in the city, one because of a political situation and the other because of sin. And the warfare was intense in families. I know personally of several families dealing with divorce, others dealing with the consequence of sexual sin and addictions in the family. Churches were struggling financially. It was a byproduct of skepticism and unbelief that the Lord said, leave it in 2018, but people brought it over into 2019. And they walked in skepticism and unbelief, and because of that, didn't trust the Lord, didn't trust the leadership that the Lord had established in the churches, and said, I'm not going to give. I'm not going to support that. Roxy and I faced intense spiritual warfare this year with our son, who is homeless, mentally ill. and her mom, who was brought into hospice this year. And so when we look at things on a daily basis that affect us, you know, we know that there are some battles that may not be over in this life. There are some battles we may be fighting all the way through until we see Jesus. And Roxy and I know that very intently. And so as I reviewed that the word that God gave us in 2019, it was a reminder that we can't forget that the battle is real. The battle is real and the casualties are real. But God is powerful. And the weapons of our warfare are mighty through God to fight our battles. And the enemy will seek to discourage, to wear out through delays, to promote skepticism, which is really another word for unbelief. People that are skeptical of things, they just don't believe in the work of God. But rather than slide into unbelief, I need to determine to stand by faith. I'm going to stand on what God has said. I'm not going to stand on what I feel. I'm not going to stand on what I see. I'm going to stand on what God says in His Word. And I've learned more than ever that God is a promise keeper, that He is a way maker, that He is a miracle worker, and we are here today because God brought us through. But don't get comfortable, because there's more to come. And I believe that 2020 will be a year of storms. 2020 will be a year of storms. It will not be a year of clearer vision, but it will be a year of tested vision. There's so many people saying 2020 and vision, oh, it's the year of vision, clear vision. No, it's tested vision. Your vision is going to be tested. But all who trust in the Lord will be safe. Not only will they survive, but they will thrive in 2020. And the Lord brought me this year to Joshua chapter 1. As you remember, Joshua didn't have a mother or a father because he was the son of none. You thought the jokes would get better in 2020. He says here in verse 2, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I said to Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the lands of the Hittites and to the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your territory. No man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage, for this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. The passage begins with Moses, his servant, being dead. My pastor, Chuck Smith, is dead. He was the one who is most known for the Moses model of leadership within the Calvary Chapel movement. And so we are in new territory. We're in a new season. And this is what I believe that God has for us in 2020. First of all, he said we are to go. we are to go. And notice here in verse 2, God says, go to the land which I am giving you. And he says, every place the sole of your foot will tread, I have given you. Now Joshua is crossing into the promised land, crossing over the Jordan. And for us as a church, the promised land is San Clemente. This is what God has given us. This is what God has called us to. And the message is simple and clear. Go to the land. Walk the land. Make yourself known in the land. And wherever you go, know that it's yours. Know that it's yours. Several years ago, the Lord spoke to me, told me to stand on the pier. And I went and I walked to the end of the pier and I turned around and he said, now look at the land. Look to the left and look to the right. To the left, I could see Dana Point. To the right, I could see, I think it was the point over by Trestles Beach. And the Lord says, I've given this land to you. This is your assignment. This is what you are called to. And he told me at that time that he would establish us as a church. That he would establish us at a church, as a church. And I believe that on December 1st, I can say with confidence that God has established us as a church. And we'll talk more about it at our dedication service on January 19th. We're going to have an evening service, so plan on being here. It's a Sunday. It's instead of our connection lunch, we're going to have a connection dinner. It's going to be great. We're going to have lots of music. Pastor David Rosales will be here, and some other guests will be here to pray for us and bless us in as the Lord does what he desires to do through us. But I believe that God established us just as he said he would. Now, what does that mean for us specifically? It means that 2020 is a year of outreach. It's a year of outreach. But notice here, it's personal outreach. It's personal outreach. It's you personally making Jesus known to your neighbors. God says, you walk the land. And as you're walking the land, as you're making yourself known in the land, it's a personal thing. It's one-on-one. It's you taking Jesus to those that he puts in your path. And all of us are called to do that. Every single one of us have that assignment on our lives. God says, be confident because he's already prepared the people to receive. All he needs is someone that will go. That's how easy it's going to be in 2020. He's already preparing people. He just wants to know, will you go? Will you talk to them? And so I would invite you to pray. Pray and ask God to show you one person that you can pray for, that you can share Jesus with, that you can invite to church. Don't pray for a specific person. Don't focus on one person and think, oh, well, that person didn't work out. But ask God to open your eyes to the one that he's assigned you to the one that he's leading you to the one that he's already speaking to. And as he shows you that person, just ask them, is there something I can pray with you about? Can we pray right now? And listen to what the Lord would have you say to them. Maybe the Lord will give you a verse. Maybe the Lord will share something with you to share with them. And so be open in 2020 to being used by the Lord in these personal ways. Second of all, he says that we are to go in his presence. In Joshua 1:5, it says, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Now, theoretically, we know that God is with us, right? We're two or more are gathered in his name. God is with us. We know that theoretically he lives inside of us, so he's with us wherever we go. But the question is, are you aware of his presence? Are you experiencing his presence? Do you sense that he's with you? Not just know it mentally, but are you aware of it? Are you aware of the fact of it? As we were rehearsing this morning, all of a sudden the awareness, the Lord showed me, oh, I'm present. I'm like, oh, thank you, Lord. You're here. I know you're here. You're here with us. And the key to victorious living in 2020 is the awareness of God's presence. Those who walk in the awareness of God's presence are at rest even in the midst of storms. You remember Jesus was sleeping in the boat in the middle of a storm. How could he do that? He was in the presence. Nothing to worry about. They're not filled with worry and anxiety. They know that God is with them and will not abandon them, and so they have peace in their hearts. And so 2020 will be a year of storms, but don't be afraid. In fact, I expect the awareness of God's presence to increase. And I would ask you to pray for that. Pray for an increase in your awareness of the presence of God. Pray for an increase in the awareness of God's presence in our church. During the Welsh Revival, there was such an awareness of God on the nation of Wales that strangers getting off of the train would when they would disembark and their feet would touch the platform there, the Spirit of God would hit them and they would fall to their knees and begin repenting and turning to Jesus Christ. It was a work of the Spirit because of the awareness of God's presence that was in the place. Third, notice verse 6. He says here, the land will be divided. In verse 6, it says, be strong and of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. And to me, this speaks of new ministries, new ministry opportunities. And I believe that God has established us as a hub for ministries and ministry leaders. I believe that this is going to be a home base, a facility for people to minister from. That there will be those that will go and those that will come back. That this will be a place for sending and receiving ministries. And so I would ask you to pray. Pray for ministries to fill this building. I believe that we're a center for families. Pray for family ministries. One of the things that many people don't recognize about our church is that we made a decision that when we began that we're not necessarily going to have a traditional youth ministry. What we're going to do is we're going to incorporate our youth into our church, that when they step into high school, they're not second-class Christians, they are the leaders. They're not future leaders, they are the leaders now. When I was 16, I was the worship leader of Calvary Chapel Vista. I was teaching Bible studies. My Bible study had 40 and 50 people of all ages, even grandmas and grandpas was in. And I listened now at the things that I taught, and I thought, oh my goodness. Who would come listen to a 16-year-old kid? And yet God was using me. And so when I look at our youth today, I don't look at them as youth. I look at them as ministers. Greg Laurie was 19 when Pastor Chuck bought a church building for him and made him a senior pastor, began Calvary Chapel of Riverside that later became Harvest. I mean, when my kids were 19 and they were asking me to borrow my car, I was having problems. Like, I don't know if I can trust you with my car. And Pastor Chuck trusted Pastor Greg with a church. You see, we've bought into a lie in our culture. That the youth don't care about Jesus, don't care about church. We have to be relevant. We bought into a lie. Let me tell you something. One of the most irrelevant people on the planet was Pastor Chuck. Every person that I talked to that went to his Tuesday night Bible studies, and they would say, we never thought he was cool and hip. We just saw a man who loved the Lord and taught his word. We never looked to him for relevance. We looked to him for Jesus. And you know what? We need to quit trying to be relevant and give people Jesus. When we start giving people Jesus, it's going to break loose in this country. Trust me. I believe we're a center for equipping leaders. So pray for God to raise up equipping ministries, Bible schools, training classes, discipleship. I believe that we're a media center for the gospel. I don't ever talk about it, but we have a radio program that's in its 10th year, Worship Life Radio. It's on in Hawaii, on the Big Island of Hilo. It's on in Fresno. It's on in Alaska. Wherever they will play it for free, it's on. Because my motto is, if it's free, it's for me. Worship Life Today, our television program, has 15 programs. It's been on several internet broadcast stations, all supported by those who believe in the teaching ministry of our church. Doesn't impact our church at all and financially, but it blesses our church. I believe that we're a center for music and the arts. For the past 2 years, I've led the West Coast Worship Conference for the Calvary Chapel Association. And I used to run them for Pastor Chuck. And then when we were over with Skip Heitzik, we ran the conferences over there. We also have pioneered a music platform to encourage the writing of new worship songs called worshipsong.com. And these are all things that I believe are essential for our identity as Calvary Chapel. Calvary Chapel is known for a new song. Has always been known for a new song. For the song of revival, the song of evangelism, for the song of worship, it's been known for a new song. And that's why I always like to begin the new year with a new song. I've tasked our worship leaders, start writing songs. I don't want to sing the same songs that everybody else sings. I want to be different. Why? Because I'm different. And it's okay to be different. We're not like everybody else. We're a different church. And God is doing a fresh work in our church. The songs that are written in our church are being used all over the world. And I want to see even more happen. I want to see more worship leaders, more songwriters, more artistic expressions. I want to see evangelism bands. We have these bands now today that say they're Christian bands and they go out and they don't preach Christ. They give the Christian viewpoint of dating in their songs. You know, instead of saying, I love you, baby, let's get it on, they say, I love you, baby, let's have a prayer meeting. Stupid. I remember when bands actually preached the gospel. I believe we're a center for healing, for physical, spiritual, and psychological healing. And so pray for an outpouring of God's mercy and grace through the power of the Holy Spirit in different gifts of healing, as it talks about in Corinthians. And if you're looking to be trained in how to minister in the power of the Holy Spirit, come to our Afterglow ministry, our Afterglow meeting. It's led by Roger Charles. We see healings every time we meet. And it always amazes me when someone calls me and says, I can't make it tonight because I'm sick. I'm like, you know we pray for healing, right? But if you want to stay home and be sick, more power to you. If I'm sick, I'm going to the meeting. I want to get healed. I'm going to turn my expectation around in 2020. We're a center for compassion and the love of God. So pray for God to raise up compassion ministries. I'm asking God to raise up ministries to the homeless, to those who struggle with mental illnesses, for those that for families that are impacted by these things, for the elderly who are unable to care for themselves. These are all things that are that have been in my heart and mind. But you know, when you're wandering in the wilderness, it's hard to have a base of operations to begin to launch out in these different things. And pray in all of these things that God will bring like-minded leaders who will come alongside the vision that God has given us to lead these ministries. Now, I'm clear on my call, but that doesn't mean that our church will be limited to ministering just in San Clemente, because I believe that God will bring those to us that are ministering all around the world, that will have a global impact, and our church will have a global impact. Fourth, we're to prioritize God's word. In Joshua 1, 7 through 8, it says, "Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success." When asked to define what Calvary Chapel was, Chuck Smith said this. He said, "It is the exposition of the Word of God. It is encouraging people to read the Word of God and expounding to them the Word of God. It's really built on the Word of God. It's just God honoring His Word as He said He would." And the reason why we study the Word of God is primarily to know Jesus, but also to do what it says. To do what it says. And if you've read it, you'll realize it says to do a lot of things that we're not doing today. It says to do a lot of things that we're not doing today. One of those things is to pray for the sick to be healed. And the Bible says they will recover. They will recover. Not they might recover. We're not practicing prayer people. There are practicing physicians. If you're a doctor, I'm sorry, I don't mean to offend you, but you're just a practicing physician. You're just practicing on us. But God is the great physician. He knows exactly how to heal somebody. And that's who we represent. We aren't those people that believe in the curses of doctors or the conclusions or the findings of doctors. We're not those people that believe in the psychology experts. We are those people that believe in the Word of God and what God says and what God tells us to do. We don't believe, Roger was telling me one of Romaine's quotes when he was praying for someone who was sick. Says, "We don't believe in the machines of men. We believe in the Word of God." And so we do the Word of God. God said He would honor His Word even above His name. That's why we place a high priority on teaching God's Word. God said, "Be strong and very courageous," speaking of believing in God's Word and doing God's Word. Strength speaks of determination, which is an act of the will. Courage speaks of faith, because fear is rooted in unbelief and courage is rooted in faith. That's what you do when you encourage someone. You're reminding them of who God is and of their need to trust God. You're giving them faith. You're building them up in the faith. God says to Joshua, "Make it your determination to trust God's word." Choose to trust God's word. Fear is a feeling. It's a reaction. It's a part of your autonomic nervous system. But faith is a decision. You decide to go against what you feel, to trust in the Lord. God says, "Don't let this book of the law depart from your mouth." Talk about it. Share it. Let it fill your speech, your language. As you're spending time with the Lord in the morning and God gives you a scripture, ask the Lord, "Is this for me, or is this for me to share with someone that you're going to bring across my path this day?" And be open to what the Lord wants to do with His word. Meditate on it day and night, which means to think about it. Think about the word of God and observe to do all that is written in it. Do it. And here's the promise: for when you do, the Lord will make you prosperous. Now, I am not a prosperity teacher, but I'm just going to tell you that this word in the Hebrew means financial success. It means that God will bless you financially. And He says, and you will have good success. And what that word success means is that you will thrive. You will thrive. When everyone else is not thriving, you will thrive. When everyone else is struggling, you will be blessed. That's what it means. And the bottom line is that we are all people of the book. And so make it your commitment in 2020 to join us for Thursday night Bible study, to learn His word as we go verse by verse from Genesis to Revelation. Make it your commitment to read His word daily, to be involved in His word, to know what His word says. 90% of the counseling that I do for people is just reminding them what God has already told them in His word. It's because they don't know the word of God because they're not in the word of God. That's why when people come to me for counseling, one of the things I tell them is, I want you in Bible study. Well, what does that have to do with my marriage? Well, if you know what God says about life and you know what God says about how you are to live your life and you start living your life God's way, you think it'll impact your marriage? Absolutely. You think it will change what happens in your life? Absolutely. You think it'll bring health and healing into your relationships? Absolutely. You think it will bring stability to your job and blessing into your life? Absolutely. Absolutely. I've been in Bible study since I was 13. Every week. Well, that's a lot of church. Well, the way I look at it is I get to spend time with Jesus. Who do you get to spend time with? I get to spend time in the presence of the Lord, learning His word, learning what He says about life. And maybe if that's a bummer for you, we should have an altar call right now. Because when you get to heaven, guess what? It's going to be all of that. All the time. You're not going to have any distractions. It's just going to be you and Jesus. And I love being with His people. I love being where Jesus is. Joshua, this final admonition in verse 9, he says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Pastor Chuck used to say, don't trade what you know for what you don't know. Don't trade what you know for what you don't know. And there's a lot of things I don't know, but this I do know. God said that He will be with me wherever I go. God is with you wherever you go. And so be strong. Be courageous. Don't be afraid. Don't get discouraged. Don't get overwhelmed. Don't allow yourself to go into that place of being overwhelmed by life because God is with you. God is with you. Lean into Him. Take advantage of His strength. Take advantage of His comfort. Take advantage of His power. Take advantage of His mercy and His compassion. And so as we go into 2020, I believe that the word of the Lord is clear. God said to go and take the land that He's given us. There's storms that are going to be coming. Don't be afraid. You know, storms can be caused by demonic powers trying to stop the work of God. As we saw in Luke 8, when Jesus was crossing over to go to where the Gadarene demoniac was, and all of a sudden this wind kicks up. These huge waves. And I've heard many people explain it, you know, well, you know, it's kind of due to the geography of the area, and you can explain it. There's this pathway from the Mediterranean Sea, and the cold water hits the warmth of the desert, and it causes these storms just to kind of come up. But you see, what they don't take into consideration is what Jesus was going to do. He was going across the lake to go after the lost tribes of Israel, those that have been integrated into culture that had forgotten who they were. And as soon as he hits the shore, who meets him? A demon-possessed man. And so this storm was sent to distract. This storm was sent to stop the work of God. And what's Jesus doing? He's sleeping in the storm because he knows that it doesn't matter what happens, it's not going to stop. God has established a work in San Clemente. It's not going to stop. It's going to grow. And it's going to go from here around the world. Storms can be caused by the land spewing out its inhabitants for defiling it. As God said in Leviticus 18, the law is very clear. It says if you defile the land will spew you out. How does the land spew you out? Well, I think we're seeing some of it in our nation today. The land has been defiled. And we're seeing a record number of national disasters. I was reading an article that under the Obama administration, that the amount of natural disasters during his administration hit record highs. They've surpassed any other president in history, the number of natural disasters, tornadoes, floods, all of those sorts of things. He defiled the land by declaring that we were the largest Muslim nation in the world. We are not a Muslim nation. We've never been a Muslim nation. We're a nation under God. And President Trump changed that when he stepped into office and he declared over our nation, no, we're a nation under God. We're God's nation. Storms can be caused by natural causes. It's just part of living in a fallen world. We're going to experience storms. And often we enter into those storms because we're not walking in wisdom. We're not listening to the word of the Lord. And we see this in those that took Paul to Rome in Acts chapter 27. Paul warned them, don't leave the harbor because if you do, you're going to enter into a storm. And what did they do? They launched out. They didn't listen to Paul. They went against the word of the Lord. And they went into this storm and the storm, you know, broke the ship apart. And so the Lord came to Paul in the midst of the storm and said, tell the people it's okay. They're not going to die, but they're going to lose the ship. And guess what? They lost the ship, but they all lived. That was a lack of wisdom. They weren't listening to the word of the Lord. And so there's some storms that you're going to go through just because you're not paying attention to the Lord. You're not listening to him, and you're doing exactly what he tells you not to do. But even in the midst of that storm, we're not to be afraid. Because God said that he is with you wherever you go. And so when you encounter the storms, encounter them with confidence. Don't let it slow you down. Don't let a storm slow down the work of the Lord. Don't let a storm fill you with fear and discouragement. Go in his presence. Start new ministries. Prioritize God's word. Determined to take God at his word and to trust him. And those who do will prosper and thrive. You will prosper and thrive in 2020. And with that, I want to invite you to pray. Next week is prayer week, and we're going to have a lot of opportunities for prayer. I believe, did they get in their bulletins a list of all the prayer opportunities? I sent it over. No? Okay. Let me give you this right now. You can make copies. I anticipated that we might not have that. Steve? Or can you grab this and, yeah, make copies and put them for people on the way out? And I'll give you a list of all the opportunities we're going to have next week for prayer week. We're going to have something every day where you can pray, beginning with Sunday here at 8 o'clock. If you want to come and pray before service, we're going to begin prayer week next Sunday. And every day we'll have opportunities for people to pray. We're going to have a special afterglow service next Tuesday. So it'll be an additional, in addition to what we're doing in our normal schedule. And then on Thursday, instead of a Bible study, we're going to have a night of worship and prayer for the church to come together. And so I want to invite you to pray. Pray for this coming year. Pray for open doors to share the love of God. Pray for the prodigals to come home. I'm praying for prodigals, those that have fallen away from the Lord, those that have, you know, that have become distracted by the things of the world. I'm praying for them to come home. Pray for God to use us to reach the lost and to fill His church with people that are hungry for His word, that want to know Him and that want to do what He says. Pray for new ministries. Pray for like-minded leaders. Pray for those who are currently leading ministries here at Calvary Chapel. Let me tell you something. As I said, the battle is real, and I saw my friends taken out by the enemy. I don't know if you know how hard that is to see. Someone that you've been laboring with for decades taken down. It's very difficult. I don't want to lose any more of my friends to the enemy. And some of you have kids. You don't want to lose your kids. So let's pray. Pray for those that are leading ministries. They need that. And pray that God would continue to bless Calvary Chapel. Pray for God's blessing. Because when you pray for God's blessing, it blesses you. When God blesses our church, it blesses you. So don't sit there and think, well, you know, this is your thing. Do it for selfish reasons. We're in the me generation. It's all about selfies. So do it for purely selfish reasons. Pray that God would bless our church tremendously so you'll be blessed. Pray that God blesses me as I teach His word so that you'll be blessed. You can even pray that my jokes get better. I know that there are those who are I know that there are those that are fasting and praying over that one. And also, if you want to fast with us next week, you're welcome to do that. And we will have prayer guides for you on Sunday that will kind of walk you through, you know, what, you know, if you're going to do a fast, there's different ways you can fast, and there's a lot of different suggestions for those that want to spend that time in prayer and fasting. And I would encourage you to form prayer groups at your work and just pray for God to do something incredible in San Clemente and beyond. For God to make this a home base for ministry that will impact the world. But it begins with us. Begins with each one of us here. And God doesn't need a lot of people to change the world. He did it with 12 guys. But they were 12 guys that were sold out. Are you sold out for Him? It takes 12 guys that are sold out. I also want to ask special prayer for a friend of mine who's here this morning. He didn't know I was going to say this. But he's also a guy that's on the front line, and he's been experiencing an incredible year of warfare this year. And that's my friend Michael Riney. Michael takes a cross and he walks the streets of Las Vegas and he preaches the gospel. He said it used to be in previous years that there were many people that would be out there preaching the gospel. Now it's just him by himself. I would invite you to pray for him. That God would use him, that God would empower him and protect him. It's amazing, he said, as soon as you take the cross out, how many people are offended by the cross. And they'll start cussing him out and making references to his mom. they don't even know his mom. For no reason. People will just start up yelling at him just for having the cross out there. That's spiritual warfare on the surface. Those are things that we don't actually encounter oftentimes. But it's real. And so pray. Pray for protection. And so I want to pray for us right now. And I'm going to pray that God would inspire you, that God would speak to you, that God would empower you and fill you with vision as we go into this next year. Know that your vision is going to be tested. It's tested vision. And, you know, as I've laid out just a few of the things, I haven't really told you the whole big picture of what God has spoken to me for our church and the things that we're going to be involved with in the years to come, because I don't want to scare anybody. And as soon as I start talking those things, people get nervous. They think we're going to start tomorrow. And it's not that at all. I'm just waiting on the Lord to raise things up in his time and with his people. But I'm going to pray that God would begin speaking and instructing and leading you and giving you vision. And trust him with what he speaks to you about. Let's pray. Father, I pray for each person here, and I believe that they're here by divine providence. I believe that they're here because you wanted them here, and that you drew them by your Spirit to hear this message. Because, Lord, I believe that there are going to be those that are going to encounter storms in their life this year. Many storms. But Lord, you've told us not to be afraid, for you are with us in the storm. Some storms are going to be attempting to stop the vision that you've put in their hearts. Storms sent by the enemy to discourage. But Lord, really, you use them as storms to test the vision that's within us, to encourage us, to strengthen the vision, to strengthen our determination to follow you. Some storms are going to be storms that we didn't choose, that we didn't start. And in the midst of those storms, you're going to direct us and lead us by your word. Some storms are the result of being in a land that has been defiled by leaders that have been ungodly. And so we're reaping the benefits of their storms. But Lord, you said you would be with us through the storm, and not only would we survive the storms, but we will thrive in the storms. And so, Lord, I pray that that encouragement would be rooted deep in our hearts as we go into this next year. And, Lord, I pray for fresh ministry to be born. I pray that you would fill this place with ministry. Every day will be filled with ministry. Lord, I pray that you would raise up like-minded leaders. Lord, I pray that for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit and power and might. Lord, I want to see the raw power of God poured out in San Clemente. Not just goosebumps and feelings. Not just good times and good fellowship. But Lord, an outpouring to such a degree that even those that would drive through the city would sense the real presence of God. That there would be something different about our city. And Lord, I pray that we as a church would be in the center of that. Or that this would be a place, Lord, where that holy expectation of the presence of God would reside in. The Kol Yahweh, that holy expectation of God. Lord, I pray that you would empower us as your people to represent you. And even now, Lord, you're giving vision. Even now, Lord, you're giving direction. You're speaking to people about the one person, Lord, that you desire for them to reach out to. Even now, Lord, you're stirring hearts. You may not know what that stirring is for. You just have this anticipation for something. Be ready and open for God to speak to you and reveal that to you. And Lord, I pray for those that find themselves in a place where their life has become static, where their life has become so routine, so predictable. They've settled into a norm of just unbelief, unexpectation, not really expecting you to do anything. They've allowed themselves to be filled with skepticism. Lord, this morning I pray that you would stir them up. Stir them up. Stir up the gifts that are in them. Stir them up to love and good works, Lord. Stir them up, Lord. And the Lord is telling me that there are those that have come into that skeptical place because you have been discouraged by church leadership. You've been let down, and so you're a little bit gun shy. And you need to give that to the Lord. Forgive those people. Surrender that to the Lord, that fear. Because you're in a new place. You're not in the old place. And let the Lord begin to breathe new life on that vision that you have let go by the wayside. And so for those that desire to re-surrender their lives to Jesus, just to surrender afresh, to go into this new year with a fresh commitment to the Lord, you can pray this prayer and mean it with all your heart. Just say, Jesus, I surrender to you. I surrender my life to you. I want to follow you. I want to be used by you. I want to know you. Forgive me for doubting you. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. Give me the power to live for you all the days of my life. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing a song, and as we do, if you would like prayer, we'll have our prayer teams in the back.